Hello, everybody. So this work that we completed over the summer with Venkat. Venkat was a visitor here for the recent years. And so we just completed this work on spatial games over the summer. So Venkat, as you know, is at UC Berkeley. Okay, so so please feel free to interrupt me anytime. It's a small community, so I should be in a position to try to answer your questions, if any. Okay, so what are spatial competition games? So initially, I think this work was started by Hotelling in about 90 years ago, and he was interested in the companies competing for customers as common.
Sorry, Dr. Bashiri, yes. I couldn't see the SQ or SQing. I don't know, it's my laptop problems or I don't know what happened. I just see myself in the people and see just my...
Okay.
We see the screen from our side, so maybe it comes from your side.
Is there anybody who sees the screen or does not see the screen?
I can see the screen, yeah.
You can or cannot?
I can.
You can?
Yes.
Okay. It seems that's my problem. Maybe I re-enter the meeting, maybe the problem.
Yeah, okay. Maybe you can try to reconnect effectively.
Okay. I have a plan.
Okay. So, so think of... some area in the Euclidean plane or in a country where these two competing companies for the time being can choose locations. Locations for outlets in this domain D, so here a square, and assume that buyers prefer the closest outlet, and so there's no price discrimination. Then the value received by each company competing for this, say, homogeneous crowd of customers can be represented as the area of the union of the Voronoi cells of the outlet points for each company. So, let me... discuss a little bit the picture of this initial Hotelling games. So there are two versions of the game, and there are actually many, but one of them is that each company, so here there is the black and the red, and both the red and the black have a certain capacity, financial capacity to create these outlets. So there is a cardinality for the outlets of the red and a cardinality for the outlets of the black, the action of each competitor is to place this, say, R red outlets and B black outlets in the domain. And here we are on, say, a subdomain of the Euclidean plane, and therefore you can draw the Voronoi cells of the outlets, and basically if there is this absence of price discrimination, those customers in the Voronoi cell of whatever company store will be attracted to that store. Okay, so the value in the Hotelling games is the area for the Lebesgue measure of the union of the Voronoi cells of its parts, its outlets. Is the initial model clear?
Yes.
Okay, and so, and this is depicted on the right where you see that I have put some coloring on the Voronoi cells, and the volume of this of in this case this polygons, convex polygons, the union of these convex polygons will be the value of the red player, and the black will get the rest. Yes.
One question. The choice of points, the processes are independent of each other, right?
There are two. Okay. So in the, I will come to random matters a bit later, but in the initial games, there is no randomness at all.
Okay.
You are IKEA and I am Habitat or whatever. So, and I can invest that many stores in this country, and I decide of where I put these stores, right? Me, IKEA, or and you, Habitat, you decide where you do, right? What you do. And so it is a in the initial game, it is a deterministic decision, which is based on, say, financial capacity. Okay.
Yes.
So at this stage, there is absolutely no randomness. It's just a purely deterministic problem. But of course, I mean, I will come to something random in a second. Okay. So any other questions on the model? Okay. So, I mean, there are several versions of the game in the first place. I mean, because you could place, like in the Go game, you could start placing stones or outlets recursively, right? So I place a stone, you place a stone, a black and a white, and then you sort of occupy space in a sort of, and that would be an iterative game. In the another version, which the one that I will discuss, I mean, you have this, you start from scratch and you have this financial capacity and you, in this number of outlets of each, for each competitor, and you place this, I said, right, R red outlets and B black ones at some places that you decide. Okay, so the main observation to, before doing entering the core of the topic is that these special competition games are ubiquitous. Actually, they show up in a variety of problems. There are quite interesting security versions of that. So, which will, in a sense, justify the fact that we will not restrain ourselves to Euclidean spaces later on. You have a space of potential attacks or defense, and it's. And let's make the point that, I mean, the in various models, the defend and attack modalities, which are closer to where a defender or an attacker has already focused its effort, might be seen as belonging to the attacker and the defender. So there are abstract versions in security where you find problems of this nature. There are plenty of ecology models in population dynamics or things of this type, where you also, when there is competition for resources, which can be food or things of this type, where regions closer to an individual of a given species, say, might belong to that class or to that species, and so on, right? And for those interested in communications, there are, of course, I mean, utility providers also a model that, of course, I mean, might be in a framework of the same nature. Okay, but let me now go to the core of the topic. This is what we propose to call Cox process hoteling games. It's a variant of the initial hoteling game. So there will be a domain which will be either as in the initial setting, say, a finite domain of the Euclidean space, or the motivations were explained a bit earlier, some abstract metric space, and the requirements will be that it be some sort of polished space, and the two things will be the possibility of defining Poisson point processes with a given intensity measure on this space. The second thing, which will be very important, you can't do any metric space. You want that the Von Neusel have sort of thin boundaries, negligible boundaries. And so I will try to explain that in more detail a bit later. And it's linked to the fact that the game is zero sum. Okay, so when you look at the general spaces, so there will be a few discussions on topological matters and a bit later. So what is a pure action? You remember in game theory, you have to randomize. So first you see what pure actions are, and then you take randomization of the action in the action space. This will, to define Nash equilibria, this is what you need. So pure actions are the choice of an intensity measure under an integral constraint. So this replaces the cardinality constraint, okay, or the investment constraint. It will be an integral constraint on the intensity measure of this Poisson things that we'll define in a second. The effect of an action will be, and now this answers Barat's question, the effect of an action, if you choose an intensity measure, is that you have your outlets placed as a Poisson point process with this intensity measure on the set domain. And the value of the player is the expected volume of the Von Neusel of the points resulting from this action. Okay, so if I come back to the sort of initial setting, say here I might have had a certain budget which amounts to choosing an intensity say with respect to Lebesgue measure, so which is not necessarily homogeneous, right? This intensity could be space dependent. But the total mass of this intensity measure on the square is fixed, and I can, if I place my intensity with much mass in a region, then I will have to put less mass in the other. Okay, and so we play this game. I choose intensity, the opponent chooses intensity, and we see the resulting thing, and we divide space into these two parts based on the Von Neusel thing. And then we count what surface we have and the expectation of that, since the decision of mine was only on intensity function, not on the points, would be the expected volume acquired by each opponent. Okay, so any questions? No questions? Okay, so the mathematical, yes.
Bonsoir, sorry, I was mute, sorry.
Yeah.
This is Daniel speaking. You are supposing that you compare the volumes, I mean, you compute the volume of the Von Neusel cells in order to estimate the gain.
Yeah.
If I'm taking your example of the shops, this suppose somehow that the users or the clients are uniformly distributed on the square. Yeah.
Yes, this is, but I will come to that a bit later because we'll, of course, this was just a motivation. That's what Hotelling did for the Lebesgue measure, but we will go to measure theoretic things in a second. But indeed, so there are two things in this initial work of Hotelling. Not only you need that, but also you need that there is no price discrimination and that the cost of transportation is the same. So is Euclidean distance actually proportional to Euclidean distance. Okay, so indeed, so we'll go to a more general model soon. And that's the general model, mathematical setting. So D will be a Polish space. There will be on this Polish space, so I start with a metric, this metric, being given, I give myself in addition on this metric space, so I can define the Borel sigma field. So it's also a measure space, And I can define a measure, eta, which will be the reference measure. So it's a positive finite measure on the Borel set of D, and the total mass is finite. So this is this will be the reference measure, which was, say, in the earlier case, indeed the Lebesgue measure or the restriction of Lebesgue measure on the square. Okay, but it, now it will be a general measure. And the assumption is that eta is diffuse, so you can do that on define diffuse measure on all these types of Pauli spaces by saying that there is no, if you take a set, there is no, there is always a smaller set that has a measure which is smaller. So a second thing is that for each collection of points in D, the eta measure of the boundary of the Voronoi cells will be zero. This is an assumption, so of course it's not always true, and there are plenty of easy metric spaces where this does not hold. And then you will consider Poisson point processes with a given intensity measure. Oops. With a given intensity measure, which admits a density with respect to this reference measure eta. Okay, so this will be your space of the result of your actions. Your action will be to choose a density with a certain budget constraint, integral with respect to eta constraint, and the result will be of your action. So it's like if your action were a bit blurred. I mean, you decide to invest that at some stores, you don't know exactly where you will be able to construct them. So there is some randomness, and also some projects fail, others work, and so the result is this random number, which is total mass is total number of stores will be Poisson outlets. Okay, and so the action space is very central, as you know, in game theory. And so what is the action space? This is the space of densities, right? So with so I call it C of rho, if my budget is rho. And so the assumption is that the total mass of the intensity with respect to the reference measure eta is rho. Okay, and so this can be seen also as a Pauli space by the following observation. You can identify L1 plus of eta with a space of measures on D which admit the Radon decoding derivatives with respect to eta, which is F. With so later on, we will look at the subspace of that, those with a total mass equal to rho. But L1 plus can be identified with a space of measures. And the space of measures is well known, can be equipped with a topology of weak convergence of measures. And it makes this, again, a good space, a Pauli space, but unfortunately non-compact. And so if C of rho, when you think of now the set of actions, is a measurable subspace of this metric space, but it is neither closed and of course not compact. Okay, so and it's very important, as you know, I mean, so the all the initial theory of the minimax was based on the fact that the action space is compact. And so here we don't have a compact space. So the two-player Cox process throttling gain can now be sort of defined in a bit more precisely. You have, so I look at two player, Alice and Bob. That's what we do in the, in for the two player game, to A and B, Alice and Bob. So you have rho A and rho B, which are the total mass available to Alice and Bob respectively. And then you have the density chosen by Alice belongs to CA, which is the set of L1 plus function with total mass rho A, same thing for Bob, and these are the pure actions. And I repeat what I already said, but now it can make it a bit more precise, that V, if for the pair of pure actions FA and FB, Alice and Bob choose the set intensities FA and FB, then the value to Alice is the expected measure of her Voronoi cells, and the same for Bob. Any questions? Okay, then let's move to the end player Cox processing hoteling game, which is a sort of a natural extension of that. You have again have this polished space D, this total mass, this finite measure eta on D, and then capacity of adjustment of the n players, rho 1 to rho n. Fi belongs to Ci, which is C of rho I. These are the potential pure actions of player I. And again, so now with the n player game, there is a value, or there is a typo, it's not players, but players. The value is the expected measure of the Voronoi self for each player, of his Voronoi self for each player. Okay, so now mixed strategies are important. As you know, in game theory, I mean, equilibria, Nash equilibria, do not exist when you consider only pure strategies. You have to look at mixed strategies. And so, in a mixed what is a mixed strategy has to be thought thoroughly in order to understand what follows. Okay, so it's on purpose that I described L1 of eta as a density with respect to eta of a measure. Because the space of measures, as I said, is a good space. I mean, it's a polished space, and so therefore I can equip this polished space, as I already mentioned, as with its Borel sigma field, and hence I am in a position to define a random f, which is the density of the random measure f. This is the way that you can think of a mixed strategy, which is simply a random variable on the space of action. Okay, so in the two-player game, a mixed strategy pair is therefore f of ma dot. Ma is the random measure, fa is its density, and dot is the value the density takes at point x in D. And a mixed strategy is a pair of independent random variables, fa ma dot, fb of mb dot, which takes a value in the product CA CB. Okay, and the n-player game is exactly the same. You mixed strategy profile is a n tuplet f1 m1 up to fn fn that belongs to the product c1 up to c, where again the random variables that show up in this profile are independent. Okay, and therefore I can now justify the name of the games that we propose for the games, because what is a point process whose intensity is a random measure? It's a Cox process. So this is the definition of Cox point process. It's a Poisson point process whose intensity measure at a higher level is also a random process. So you have, for instance, some of you are familiar with Poisson line Cox processes. So you put a Poisson point process of given intensity on the lines in R2. So but there are plenty. It's much more general. So any intensity being random gives rise to a Cox process, and hence the name. It's a Cox process. This is the result of your action. Is a Cox process Hotelling game. Okay, now Nash equilibria. So the pair of I take a mixed strategy. So let's look at the two-player game. Alice plays MA with density FA, Bob MB with density FB, and we say that this is a Nash equilibrium if the two blue equations hold. So if for every possible element GA satisfying the constraint CA, and GB satisfying constraint CB, you have these equalities that holds, that the value that Alice would get if she would place GA in place of FA of MA would be less. Okay, and the same thing for Bob. Bob has no incentive to move out from MBA from the MA MB national curriculum, because if he would play GB, any GB that satisfies the constraint, his reward would be less, his value would be less. And so here the values have to be randomized, because the expectation that shows up here is the expectation with respect to the randomization on the mixed strategies. Okay, so the Nash equilibria, not everybody is a game theorist, but are equilibria where given a mixed strategy, there is no incentive for any of the two players, Alice and Bob, to deviate from the Nash equilibrium FAMA, locally at least, FBMB. Okay, good. So this is classical, but the setting is a bit special here. And of course, you can extend that to the end player game. I won't do that. And I will enter now the stochastic geometry calculations. Any questions on that before I move to the next step? Is it clear?
Excuse me. Shouldn't GA and GB be random as well?
Yes. Let's see. But I think it's enough to have this in order to get the random case as well. So I think it's this condition is sufficient.
Thank you.
Okay. So for the value function, now we start with the stochastic geometry part. We have not used it at all. It's just So let's define the ball of center y and radius that passing through x. This is the b y to x notation up there as the set of points which are which distance to y, the set of points z that belong to d. And so d may be a very strange object. So calling it a ball is true, but I mean don't think it of, as a ball in you are used to. The set of points z, which whose distance to y, the center, is less than d of xz. So it's really this this notation of looking at the ball of center y and whose radius is that defined by x with respect to y. Okay, and so the key thing which follows from Campbell's formula and the Slivniak theorem is that in the two-player game, so the two-player game features this space D, this Polish space D, this measure eta, and this rho A and rho B, which are the budgets of Alice and Bob, then the pure, if take the pure strategy Fn Fb, the value of Alice then is given by the top formula that I will read and parse and explain in a second, that the value of Alice when she plays Fa and Bob Fb is the integral over d of Fa of x, eta dx, and the inner integral is the integral over y, eta dy, and you see there is this, let me perhaps, let's see whether this works. Can I annotate here because it's a bit, so it becomes technical now. Okay, so this is the, can you see my writing? Yes?
Yes.
No? Okay, good. Okay, so I look at that. So I was saying you integrate with respect to the density Fa, with respect to eta dx, and then you integrate the function, which is the integral for all y in d of with respect to eta dy of a function, which is an exponential function, and which reads like integrate over, so u is the argument, integrate over the ball centered at y and whose radius goes to x, passes by x, the integrate the function f of u plus fb of u, okay? And so when you think about it, so there are two things in there. So what is the value of Alice? So you recognize Campbell's formula fundamentally here, because you will integrate with respect to f of a eta dx. So you will replace the sum over all points x that belongs to the point process of Alice by this integral. Okay, this is Campbell's formula. And now comes Slivniak formula that shows up in the thing here. So you want to integrate over the Voronoi cell. Okay, so, and you ask every point U, do you belong U to the Voronoi cell you ask every point Y, whether this point Y belongs to Voronoi cell, right? Of X, right? And so what is the condition for this to hold? This is the empty ball condition, okay? When you think of the Poisson law now, you look at the sum of the intensities of the two Poisson point processes, Fa of U plus Fa of B, and you ask for the point Y to belong to the Voronoi cell of X. This happens if and only if this ball B of Y to X is empty of points. And this is the formula for the Poisson stuff. And so the fact that you can use Poisson in spite of the fact that you say that Alice has a point at X is fundamentally Slivniak theorem, right? Okay, so this is a proof. Is it clear? Or should I repeat?
Could you repeat, sir, like why is the sum inside the exponential?
Why the sum? Right, because I mean Bob and Alice compete, and so the point, the Voronoi cell that Alice gets is bounded by any action of Alice, but also any action of Bob. Okay, and so the point process when you look at the initial picture that you had, okay, right here. Okay, so the tessellation, as you see before coloring it, is the tessellation of a Poisson point process of intensity of the total intensity, the sum of Bob and Alice intensities, and therefore that's why there is the Fa plus Fb.
Okay. Oh yes.
Okay. So that's the key thing. Right. So this formula. So it's not difficult to prove. But it's central throughout because it's what will give the minimax things later on. Okay. So this is very central. And so you can extend it to the n-player game having that a pure strategy profile being given f1 up to fn, and the value to player I is given by the same type of formula. You integrate with respect to... so let's move back to the... full screen. Oops. Okay. The integral with respect to the Fi density, and you get now the things that I was mentioning in to answer Bharat's question. That the what shows up is the sum of the intensity, the n intensities. Okay. So essentially, I mean, so it requires a detailed proof, right? So. But it's those who are familiar with stochastic geometry will get it. Okay, and now comes the key thing, where the Voronoi boundary assumption thing pops in, that actually we have in a sense a zero sum game, in the sense that the sum of the values of Bob and Alice is constant, whatever their decisions. And what is the constant? Is the total mass eta of d times 1 minus e minus rho. So in a sense, this is the probability that there is at least one point. Okay, so there is so if nobody plays, then there is no reward for Bob and Alice. So it's not quite a zero-sum game in the sense that, close to it. And the key thing which replaces the zero-sum game is this identity that whatever actions you take, pure actions you take, the sum of your values is a constant. Okay, and the same thing holds in the n-player game. Okay, now what are constant strategies? Constant strategies are the strategies where you your density is constant, namely I call this rho bar A and rho B, rho bar B. So this is the case where the density is rho A over eta of D, which has total mass rho A, and same thing for Bob. And so when you play with the value formula, you immediately get this nice proportionality thing that if you play a constant strategy, then with your budget constraint, then your reward or your value is proportional to your investment. Okay, so you see these formulas, constant times rho A and the same constant times rho B for Bob. Okay. So now comes the key thing, which is the sort of key observation, which leads in some cases to Nash equilibria, that this is a strict concavity of the value function. So the lemma says that the function, if you fix FB and you look at the value of Alice and how this value depends on the function FA, so FA is, so you can look at linear combinations of FA, so the set CA is a convex set. And so this function of the value is a strictly concave function on CA for fixed FB. Okay, and the proof is as follows. So it's equivalent to proving, because of the identity that when you fix FB, the function FA gives VB of FA and FB is strictly convex on CA because the sum is a constant for fixed FB. But you plug in the formula that I just explained, okay? And what you see here is an integral. So now FB is fixed, so you have a mixture through FB of integrals of an exponential function, okay? And clearly, if you look at what happens for the integral of this exponential function, it is clear that it's strictly convex for each fixed FB in the FA variable, right, because of the exponential form. Okay, so the value function, we learned from that, that the value function is strictly concave. The value of Alice is strictly concave in its, her decisions when Bob's decisions are taken. And a dual of that is that the function, value function of Alice, when you take FA to be fixed, is a strictly convex function in Bob's decisions. So, which is the very close to the Feynman setting, right? For zero-sum games. Okay, so let's start with a symmetric case and give the first results. Suppose now you add a bit more stuff, but we will remove it soon. I will explain why. That D not only is what I said, maybe a Polish space, but also that there is a transitive group of metric preserving automorphisms, which are such that eta is preserved by the action of this group of transformations, okay, of automorphism. And so typical examples to move to concrete things would be that you look at the flat torus, or torus in higher dimension and look at the translation on the torus, or you could look at the sphere and or objects of this type, which are where you, in addition to the metric, have this group of measure preserving metric preserving transformation that preserve therefore the what would be the analog of the Lebesgue measure would be the Haar measure on this structure. Okay, and what is the result? First theorem, if you have such a metric preserving group of automorphisms, then the pure strategy pair, which is the constant one, rho A of eta of D, rho B over eta of D, is the unique Nash equilibrium of the two-player game with constraints rho A and rho B. And same thing in higher damage for more more players, right? N players, you can define the pure strategy profile with constant intensities or densities. And this is again the unique Nash equilibrium of the N player game with these budgets. Okay, so the key step in the proof is in terms of the property that you can compute what happens in terms of if one of the two players, say Bob, adopts the the constant strategy rho bar b, then by convexity or concavity, you get that the value that Alice gets if she plays FA for any strategy FA will be less than what she would get. This is the concavity thing by playing the constant strategy rho bar A, and you know the value of that. You have a symmetrical statement for Bob. When you adapt the two things, you get back the conservation rule that I explained. And therefore, for all strategies of FA of Alice different from rho bar of A, you use then the fact that there is this group of major transferring automorphisms. There will exist, if FA is different from rho bar of A, it's not constant, a translate with respect to this group, let's call it F prime of A, which is different from from F of A. And use again the concavity lemma to say that the value of one half of the strategy FA plus F prime of A will be strictly more than the half the value of FA and half the value for Alice of F prime A, but FA is measure preserving. The translations preserve eta, and therefore these two things are the same, and you get the strict inequality. Okay, so therefore any FA else than rho bar of A cannot be a maximizer of Alice value, and therefore you get the announced result. Okay, so this is the first thing. So let me wrap now, and because before going to more structural results. So if you place yourself in on this Cox-Hotelling game, Cox-process Hotelling game on a space which is not only a poly space, but also is endowed with a group of measure preserving. Metric preserving and measure preserving automorphisms, then you get the fundamental result that there is a unique Nash equilibrium, which is the constant strategy, the constant density strategy. Okay, constant with respect to eta. So if the eta could be the density, to answer a question that Daniel asked, and so eta could be something else than the Lebesgue measure, right? In some okay. Now let's move to the general case. I will have to go fast because I have about 10 more minutes. I started a bit late, but I will try to keep in time. So, which is to go to the case where you have no symmetry assumptions. Okay, and so and it's important, as I said, because you can. I mean, if you think of this example that I gave with of the security thing, I mean, then the way you would place this Poisson point precise is in the space of modalities, and this has nothing to do with the Euclidean space. So the Hotelling thing as a concept, as incarnations in strange in things which are general metric spaces. Let's go. Okay, we state results in the for n is equal to 2 to. So the thing is that looking at general metric space is not a joke. So here is an example where there is no Nash equilibrium. So you take something which is very Euclidean, it's interval minus one half, one half. Eta is the Lebesgue measure. Okay, so of course, I mean, here you don't wrap it, it's not a torus, it's just the thing, and it has these ends and this center, right? So then you play with the integral expression for the value function, and you prove in a few couple of pages that first, the constant strategy is not a Nash equilibrium of the game, and if the density is total density is small enough, rho a plus rho b less than log 4, then the game has no Nash equilibrium. Okay, so I mean, you see a very simple example of a very good poly space subset of the real line where there is no group of automorphisms which is preserving the the distance and the measure, and where you are in bad shape. Okay, so here are a few results that we got on this general case. First one is that if a Nash equation exists, it must be pure. Okay, and so this is a one-liner almost. So, and it goes through the again concavity lemma. So concavity lemma, which follows itself from the integral expression. So it's a very simple conditional expectation stuff. You push inside the conditional expectations with respect to MB, and because MA is independent of MB, you get that the if you would take the value here, I look at the value for Alice at the expected value of FA and of MA and at the random FB of MB, then this is strictly more. So actually, the strict concavity shows that unless the strategy of Alice is pure, by taking I mean you as long as not pure, you can improve. Okay, and this is strict. Okay, so conclusion: every Nash equilibrium must be pure. Second thing, I think I will not prove it, although the proof is very beautiful, is that there is a unique Nash equilibrium. And so this is a bit subtle, and so it goes along playing with the, you assume that there are two Nash equilibria, and you play with these two Nash equilibria back and forth. Then you get that necessarily the value function at these two equilibria must be the same. This is what is written in red in the middle here. And then you use the strict concavity to deduce from that that necessarily the function GA is equal to HA and GB is equal to HB. So so in summary, every equilibrium is pure, and there is a unique pure equilibrium. But you don't know, and you know that there are cases where it doesn't exist. This is completely general, right? Okay, and the last thing, which is perhaps the most interesting, is that if a Nash equilibrium exists on a general polyspace, then it is pure and proportional. Okay, so we prove this proportionality thing, of course, in the in the case where there is a group of automorphisms. But so here we prove that if it exists, and we know it's not always the case, so I'll say it's not granted. I mean, these are very simple counterexamples. Then actually, this is what is written at the end of the page: if GAGB is a pure Nash equilibrium, Alice gets the same value at rho A over rho B GB, and so GA is equal to this Nash equilibrium to rho A over rho B GB. Okay, so that's the statement. Okay, so let me now so to wrap up on this part. So when you remove the symmetry, then you don't have existence, but if there is existence, there is uniqueness, there is purity, and there is proportionality. So the strategies are what you prove is that the strategy, if they exist, are proportional to rho A. So they are of the form rho A times F for the intensity of Alice, and rho B times F for the intensity of Bob. F is not necessarily equal to 1, as we have in the case with this automorphism story. So here it's a bit more general, but proportionality is still there. That, okay. Okay, so last thing I want to discuss before concluding is which is actually quite important at the level of ideas, is the notion of uniform integrability. So the key point that I want to make here is that when you have this concave convex property for the value function in a game, then you can quite easily use, this is the minimax theorem, the Feynman minimax theorem, you can deduce from, or actually in the simplest case, you can deduce that zero-sum games have at least one Nash equilibrium. Okay, so this is a very classical thing. And so you can extend that. There is an extension of the Feynman theorem, this minimax theorem, to function spaces, and it's called Sion's theorem. Okay. And so actually, why is all this difficult in a sense? Because the space of action is non-compact. This is the fundamental reason for which, unless you put special symmetries, you don't have, you are not granted the existence of. Right. So if it exists, it's good, it's proportional, it's pure, it's unique, but it's not clear that there exists one. And the reason is that the space of action is not compact. And so then the idea, I mean, you do that, everybody would do, say, oh, let's try to make it compact. And actually, one knows how to compactify that. This is uniform integrability. So you would look at functions, now the class of functions C. So you take a function phi from R plus to R plus, which is convex, increasing, and such that the lim of phi of x over x is infinity. So the good convex function. Okay. Then you pick a constant k, a budget rho, and you look at the class Rosen C rho, you look at the class C rho phi k, which is a set of functions which actually are such that when you integrate them, rather not f of x, but now phi of f of x, this convex function with respect to the Eta measure, it's less than k. And so it's linked to uniform integrability. So actually, this is a class of uniformly integrable random variable functions, the f functions. So this is the classical result. Okay, so, and this, the good thing is that these sets C, rho, phi, k are convex for a given phi, rho, and c. And therefore, its closure, the closure of any such set for the topology of weak convergence is compact. Okay, and so then the theorem is that if you restrict yourself to actions which have this uniform integrability condition, this closure is compact, that's what I just said, and then you can define a class of restricted Cox-Otterling games where the pure actions are restricted to functions which are densities with respect to eta, but in this class, class that preserves the fact that the subspace in question is compact. And then you can extend all the earlier things, which are essentially based on convexity, and so the spaces, subspaces are convex in addition to be compact. So all earlier statements about purity, uniqueness, and proportionality work because they are deduced from convexity and proportionality as well, and the theorem, which follows from the extension of Feynman's minimax theorem to functional spaces is that every restricted, so restricted is with respect to phi to phi and k in addition to rho, every restricted cost process Otterling game has a Nash equilibrium. And therefore, all the results for this class, existence, purity, uniqueness, proportionality, hold. Okay, so I'm just on time. There are lots of interesting things to do. Mathematical things, conditions under which a Cox process Otterling game as a Nash equilibrium without restricting the space actions of players, pure actions of players. So, I mean, here we have restricted it strongly, and we would like to find a sense of condition for this to exist, and we don't know. And there are lots of computational things understanding this, when you have this proportionality thing, there is a function floating in the middle here, f, and try to be able to compute the common F, which is used in the proportionality thing. Okay, that's it. And so this was posted in August. So this is the archive number.
Thanks, François. So any question in the audience? Yeah, Daniel.
You try to. I have an idea.
Yeah.
Can we consider the game in the whole Euclidean plane? For example, the two intensity measures should be stationary, and we look at the intensity measure of the Voronoi cells.
Intensity measure? Because intensity is inversely proportional. Yes, you would like to maximize. So intensity is inversely proportional to volume. So you want, right? Yes. So you want to minimize your, for a given budget. You want to that your cells. Yeah, that's a very good, valid point. That's quite interesting. To extend it to the stationary setting. So we didn't think about it, but it's a beautiful idea. Yes. So whether you can define a Hotelling game for the stationary case with replacing values volume per unit space, which is that's a beautiful question. So the key thing is that perhaps we can extend this computational thing. Everything is based on this convexity stuff, okay? but it's very important that up to now that we have total mass bounded. But if we move to sort of density stuff, there might be ways to leverage that and to get expressions and to. Because actually, we don't rely at all on the fact that the space is compact. The existence of Nash equilibria is not at all linked on the minimax von Neumann or Sion theorem, right? It's linked to pure convexity arguments. And therefore, the fact of moving, yeah, that's a very good idea. Beautiful suggestion.
The problem is that there is no pure action despite the constant action, but instead we should look at ergodic.
Yes, ergodic actions. Yeah, right. Yeah, so that's beautiful questions. Yes, I mean, what about IKEA and Habitat having being active in the whole universe, and and you have to choose the planets on which you put your. Okay, yeah, very good. Yeah, thank you. It's a very nice suggestion.
I might have a question, if possible. Bartek is speaking.
Hi.
May I ask?
Sure.
So, and how, if we leave the Poisson world, meaning that your pure actions, actually will be no pure actions, and there will be pure actions, you have a density, but your distribution can be arbitrary. It does not have to be, in other words, you have a mean measure, still in the compact setting. You have mean measure, like your function that is your mean intensity of your Cox process, but your distribution can be arbitrary. In that sense, you have only non-pure actions or probabilistic actions, I think. Is this that then you don't have explicit expression for the value for these Voronoi cells, but you know Campbell formula holds. You don't have Slivniak, but you have, I mean, the, since you don't, if I get it correctly, you need, fundamental thing is this concavity, convexity. as well as this constant. So constant sum is, of course, holds.
Yes, it's equivalent to zero sum gain. Yes, yeah. It's crucial, right? It's really what replaces the minimax, concavity, convexity,
How much is related to, how much of the work is, these beautiful results are related on the explicit expression for these values, or how much just only on concavity, which I don't know, maybe one can prove in this more general setting.
Well, there might be parametric classes where it works, but I mean, when you think, if you allow deterministic things with a budget total mass, right? So then you come back to the containing the initial Hotelling game, right? So if you if you don't Poisson randomize one way or another and look at a parametric class, I mean, you come back to quite difficult problems, which are the deterministic Hotelling games.
Okay.
And so if it contains that, I mean, you can't expect to find simple and beautiful results. So what would be interesting would be to get that result for a good class of functions, for instance, determinanto.
Yeah, okay, I see.
Too general, I mean, it will contain the Hotelling problem. So it's very unlikely that you will gain a lot by randomizing, actually. And so you are back to square one. And so so what very little is known on this setting. So but parametric classes.
Attracting or repelling actions like indeed determinantal, permanental, for example.
Yes, okay. Yes. And so I think, looking at such parametric classes, you might try to extend the value formula and then to check whether we have concavity or convexity and try to work out analogs of that. Yeah, it's a very good suggestion. Yeah. So currently we we have not thought of that, but it would be a good value. Yes, very good. Yeah.
Thank you.
François?
Yep.
If I understand correctly, the equilibria is a region while what is important for the players is the total volume they will have, the total number of clients, whatever. It could be the case that they are interested in a not the total number of clients, but in the return of investment, which means if increasing the density will maybe increase the revenue, but not that much, maybe they will prefer to put the money in another business. So is there a way to consider the ratio between the volume and the density? The volume they will acquire over the density means the revenue over the investment?
So you want to change the value function?
Yes.
Okay.
Instead of talking about the total gain, and this is what they're playing about in this game, I want to think about the return of reinvestment.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Which would be what? Which would be just normalize the sum, I mean, the current value through the budget of a given player, right?
Through the frequency, through the density, sorry, which is what they're trying
to... The total mass of the density.
Yes, right.
Yeah. So what you see is that, I mean, there is a flavor of it because, I mean, what we prove very generally, even on, frightening metric spaces, that if there is a Nash equilibrium, it will be proportional to your investment, right? So, and this is completely general. It is for every space, every measure.
Yeah.
And there is an unknown function which is hidden, but proportionality with respect to the investment will be, so what you would want, I suppose, I mean, if you are interested in, is it the proportionality constant, which will be the same for the two players, actually, if there is an Nash equilibrium.
Right.
And so this is linked to the, I think, computational part that you mentioned, which indeed is what is the value you get per euro or whatever invested. But if you change the value function, I mean, I think there might be a problem. Everything is linked to this beautiful Slivniak stuff. And okay, so I don't know, but so I mean the revenue per investment is exactly linked to the unknown function that shows up. So it will be very easy in the Euclidean space when the reference measure is the Lebesgue measure or something which is computational or like on the sphere. But if you are on the more general spaces, there is an unknown function f floating which shows up in the proportionality stuff. And what you want is compute this function. And so, that's one of the open problems.
Thank you.
Other questions? So thank you again, François, for your presentation.
Thank you for your beautiful questions.